Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Today's lecture is in continuation with the lectures which I am already delivering to you regarding the contact dermatitis. So another aspect of contact dermatitis is an irritant contact dermatitis. So we'll discuss in detail about the irritant contact dermatitis in today's lecture. Irritant contact dermatitis is defined as a non-immunologic. This is important, non-immunological local inflammatory reaction characterized by erythema, edema, or corrosion following a single or repeated application of a chemical substance to an identical cutaneous site. The important aspects in this definition are the non-immunologic and local inflammatory reaction and single or repeated application. That means even a single application can cause irritant contact dermatitis. It is important, since we have discussed in detail the allergic contact dermatitis, before proceeding further, I think it is important that we compare the differences between irritant and allergic contact dermatitis. Irritant contact dermatitis is a commoner form of eczema rather than allergic contact dermatitis. So most of the contact dermatitis which we encounter in our day-to-day life is due to irritants rather than allergic contact dermatitis. Irritant contact dermatitis is localized to the site of contact, while the allergic contact dermatitis extend beyond the site of contact. So the irritant contact dermatitis will have a very well demarcated boundary. However, in allergic contact dermatitis, the boundaries will not be well demarcated. Concentration of substance to produce the reaction should be high in irritant contact dermatitis. On the other hand, in allergic contact dermatitis, a minute amount of substance can produce the reaction because the skin is already sensitized to that particular chemical. There is no immunological process involved in irritant contact dermatitis. However, the type 4 hypersensitivity is involved in allergic contact dermatitis. And sensitization takes about 2 to 3 weeks to produce a reaction at the first time. There is no specific diagnostic test available for irritant contact dermatitis. However, the patch test is very useful and helpful in diagnosis of allergic contact dermatitis, and we have discussed patch test in detail. Different types of irritant contact reaction which are encountered are the burns. Then irritant contact dermatitis like acute toxic irritant contact dermatitis and cumulative irritant or insult contact dermatitis. One of those reaction is acute or toxic and other is cumulative or insult type of contact dermatitis. Then there can be transient or immediate non-immunological contact urticaria. Sometimes subjective irritant response. No objective sign, but just subjective irritant response to some chemical. Some different kind of irritant reactions are encountered like pigmentary or granulomatous response. Other reactions which can also occur because of contact of certain chemicals include folliculitis. We see folliculitis in response to tar and oils and arsenic trioxides and fiberglass. Acne. Halogenated aromatic hydrocarbons can cause acne. Miliaria, aluminium chloride or occlusion, hyperpigmentation, phototoxic agents, metal, arsenic, silver, gold, mercury, bismuth, they can all induce hyperpigmentation. So these are not exactly the irritant contact dermatitis, but these are the other reactions other than dermatitis, which can be induced by irritant chemicals. Hypopigmentation. Substituted phenol and catechols. Granulomatous reactions can occur because of silica, talc, and beryllium. They induce the foreign body giant cell reaction. Alopecia can occur because of borax and chlorophene dimers. So, in addition to dermatitis, these irritant chemicals can also cause very different types of other reactions. Epidemiology. The point prevalence of hand eczema of 5.4% female were twice as commonly affected as compared to males. And 35% cases of hand eczema was thought to be irritant in nature. The most frequent source of exposure were unspecified chemicals, water, detergents, dust, and dirt. Pathogenesis. The skin barrier. Skin provides the first and most important line of defense against the exogenous noxious agent. The surface film or barrier film is the first line of defense. It is composed of sebum, emulsified with sweat, and breakdown products of horny layer. You all know about this barrier, the skin barrier. The principal epidermal barrier resides almost entirely in stratum corneum. Damage to stratum corneum is normally followed by increase in percutaneous absorption and increase in transepidermal water loss. For certain materials, there may be second barrier at or near the dermoepidermal junction or the basement membrane. But the most important is the epidermal barrier. The dermoepidermal junction is not a very significant barrier. Mechanism of action of irritant. An irritant is any agent, physical or chemical, which is capable of producing cellular damage if applied for a sufficient time and in sufficient concentration. Remember this definition. Any physical or chemical substance then can produce cellular damage if applied for sufficient time and in sufficient concentration. Immunological memory is not involved, and such kind of reactions can occur without prior sensitization. Dermatitis arises when defense or repair capacity of the skin is exhausted. Strong irritants will induce a clinical reaction in almost all individuals, whereas less potent irritant dermatitis only developing in most susceptible or in situation where repeated contact with irritant are seen. That means if a substance is irritant, then it will result in a reaction in every individual, irrespective of the fact that what is the skin type, how is the skin barrier working, how is the repair mechanism working. However, weaker chemical irritants can be selective in causing irritant contact dermatitis. In laboratory, the barrier disruption have been shown to induce interleukin 1A release and upregulation of tumor necrotic factor alpha and granulocyte macrophage colony stimulating factor. All these cytokines are released or produced after the barrier disruption, and further inflammation is caused because of these cytokines. Detergents act by destroying the lysosomal enzymes in horny layer, whereas at higher concentration they will dissolve cell membrane and damage the lysosomes, hence resulting in barrier disruption. Organic solvents such as methanol or chloroform will damage the blood vessels, causing hyperemia. And DMSO is very effective degranulation of mast cells. These are the different mechanisms of causation of irritant dermatitis. This is a multifactorial view of dermatitis. They are constitutional factors. They are irritant factors and allergic factors. We are not discussing the allergic factors. We are discussing the constitutional factors, which can be atopy. So patient is having atopy, has a more chances of developing this irritant contact dermatitis, race, skin color, phenotype. Usually white people are more susceptible. Then young age and old age are more susceptible to develop dermatitis. Those patients having a defective skin barrier and repair capacity are more susceptible to develop irritant contact dermatitis. Then patients having eczema elsewhere are more susceptible to develop dermatitis. Then irritant factors. Molecular structure of a chemical, its hydrophobicity, its inherent toxicity, its concentration, the vehicle in which it is present, solubility, duration, and type of contact. All the factors contribute to the type and severity of irritant contact dermatitis. Then there are certain histological differences between an irritant contact dermatitis and allergic contact dermatitis. The acute reactions in most irritants are characterized by spongiosis and intracytoplasmic vacuolation. More severe reactions can cause nuclear pycnosis, cytolysis, intraepidermal vesicles, bulle or epidermal necrosis. So, in allergic contact dermatitis, the findings are prototype to any eczema, that is spongiosis and lymphocytic or eosinophilic exocytosis. However, in irritant contact dermatitis, the changes are more of cellular damage and of necrosis. That is nuclear disruption, cellular disruption, and epidermal necrosis. Immunopathology. Elevated level of prostaglandin E1 and E2, as well as 12 hydroxy tetronic acid. Both of these cytokines are elevated. Following exposure to some irritants, there is increased level of tumor necrotic factor alpha, interleukin 1, 6, and 8, and granulocyte macrophage colony stimulating factor. I've discussed it before. Cytokines exhibiting anti-inflammatory characters such as interleukin 10 are likely to play an important role. Although there is no memory T cells, there is no efferent or efferent pathway of immunology, there is no Th2 or Th1 response, but still, the presence of irritant chemicals on the skin will induce certain cytokine production, and these cytokines will play role in inflammation and dermatitis. Predisposing factors. Some individual predisposing factors and then environmental factors. Individual factors. Genetic and racial background. Those with fair skin are susceptible to ultraviolet B and to different chemicals. Then age. I have told you very young and very old people are susceptible to irritant contact dermatitis. Sex. Women are more frequently reported to have irritant contact dermatitis, which can be related to the differences in exposure to those chemicals. Site. Skin of face, scrotum, back of hand are the most vulnerable sites to irritant contact dermatitis. Skin disease and atopy. Percutaneous absorption is facilitated by inflammatory changes in the epidermis. Thus, an irritant contact dermatitis can promote penetration of allergens, and conversely, an allergic contact dermatitis can facilitate penetration of irritant. So both the two dermatitis are mutually aggravating. Atopic seems to be more easily irritated, mainly because of already damage to the barrier function and the epidermis. Certain environmental predisposing factor to irritant contact dermatitis, like high temperature leading to reduce in barrier function and increase in penetration. Then low humidity leads to decrease in water content of stratum corneum. This type of dermatitis occur in winters. Chapping, which is dryness, and hyperkeratotic form of hand eczema are common in winters. Occlusion promotes percutaneous absorption. For example, rubber and plastic gloves, wrist straps, rings, waterproof adhesives, shoes, boots, clothes, and natural folds of skin provide such kind of occlusion and resulting in increase in predisposition to develop the irritant contact dermatitis. What are the predisposing factors related to the chemicals and physical agents? Detergent effect of combined removal of both lipids and water-holding substances produces chapping and dermatitis. That detergents, frequent use of detergents will result in disruption of the lipid barriers or the barrier, skin barrier, resulting in dermatitis, in dryness, leading to dermatitis. Alkaline solutions again have a deleterious effect because of its effect on the horny layer and hence promoting the percutaneous absorption. How will we will be able to identify the irritant? In vitro testing include testing on chorioallantoic membrane of hen's egg, red blood cell assay, and cytotoxic testing on BALB and C3T3 fibroblast. All are of laboratory. More irritancy testing in animal and human is done by predictive with done on a predictive basis using a variety of technique, include the Drays test, the chamber scarification test, and 21-day repeat insult test. Drays test is a very controversial test in which the irritant chemical is applied on a rabbit eye. So these are different tests which are employed to check irritants, but all of them, they are of mainly used in laboratory research and of no practical implication. Recent protocol of human testing, 4-hour irritant patch testing against standard irritant contact, internal controls. So this kind of patch testing has not gained a lot of popularity, but this is a new thing which is being introduced. It will be similar to the normal patch test, but the time of viewing would be short, that is 4 hours. Other protocols for these kind of patch testing has not been defined as yet. You may have to search the internet and Google for the protocols of this irritant patch testing. Clinical features of, I have mentioned the different type of irritant reactions that which can occur, the first of which is the chemical burn. So rapid onset of painful erythema, often within minutes, at the site of exposure, followed by blistering and developing of a necrotic ulcer. This is a chemical burn. For example, you are doing a chemical peeling with an irritant or a strong acid. It would result in a chemical burn. You would call it as an irritant contact dermatitis, subclass as burn. Symptoms coincide with exposure, but with some chemicals, including phenol, a weak hydrofluoric acid, the onset may be delayed. Most acid like sulfuric acid, nitric acid, hydrochloric acid, or alkalis like sodium, calcium, and potassium hydroxide, wet concentrates, and sodium and potassium cyanides can cause chemical burns. So long list of chemicals. This is the caustic burn as a result of wet cement. Then this is another type of irritant reaction, that is symptomatic or subjective irritant response, not an objective irritant. That is, nothing is visible on the skin, but some irritants, patients complain of subjective sensation of stinging, burning, and smarting. So if a patient gave history that he or she is having the burning or stinging sensation following application of a chemical, don't just refute it and send the patient home as being a dodger. He may be having this subjective irritant response to that chemical. Immediate type stinging. Some chemicals will cause painful sensations within second of contact. These include acids, chloroform, menthol, and ethanol. The sensations abate quickly following removal of irritant substance. Delayed type stinging. Typically, there is no immediate stinging, but discomfort develops within 1 to 2 minutes, reaches a maximum of 5 to 10 minutes, and fades slowly over the next half an hour. Example again is the chemical peeling, if you have done yourself. Example, phenol. There are many phenol, salicylic acid, aluminum chloride, sodium hydroxychloride, benzyl peroxide, which we use in acne. Sensation is not alleviated by washing off the offending chemical. It will take some time or use some other cream for treatment, for cure. Then immediate non-immune contact urticaria. It can be allergic and it can be toxic. If it is toxic, then it is non-immunologic. If it is allergic, then it is immunological contact urticaria. Then it characterized by developing of wheals within minutes and fades within hours. They may appear on both normal and damaged or eczematous skin and present only as transient symptomatic erythema or as full-blown urticaria. This non-immunological contact urticaria occur without prior sensitization and reaction remain localized. Irritant contact eczema is the inflammatory reaction of the skin to external agents where no immunological mechanism is involved. We have discussed that the toxic insult to skin from the physical or chemical agent that is capable of producing cell damage if applied for sufficient time and sufficient concentration. These are the few common irritants. Water can be a very common irritant, especially in low humidity environment. Detergents or soaps. In corona time, we have encountered these common irritants because of excessive use of soaps. Solvents, abrasives used in industrial cleansing agents, alkalis including cement, acid, cutting oil, desiccant powders, organic solvent, oxidizing agents, reducing agents like phenol, plant like true and buttercups, animal enzymes, and dust and soil. There are two types of irritant contact dermatitis, the acute irritant contact and cumulative insult. The acute irritant results from a single exposure from a strong irritant, characterized by burning and stinging sensation, limited to site of contact, does not spread from the site of contact. Initially, there will be redness, dryness, edema, inflammation, pain, and vesiculation. Later on, there can be bully and tissue necrosis. This is the acute irritant eczema. Then cumulative irritant contact eczema. It is mostly of occupational nature and result from repeated exposures and damaging insults. The insults include both chemical irritants and variety of harmful physical factors such as friction, microtrauma, low humidity, heat, cold, and solvents. It mostly affects the thin exposed skin over the dorsa of the hands, web spaces, and face and eyelids. I have told you these are the common site of irritant contact. It presents with localized patches of dry, slightly inflamed and chapped skin. This reaction is increased under occlusion and on mucosal surfaces, in low humidity, and in extreme of weather. These are, you can see this erythema and scaling. These are the low intensity cumulative irritant contact dermatitis. Some professions are associated with higher incidence of irritant contact eczema, like hairdressers, like we all medical people, the cleaning industry, agriculture and horticulture, food preparation, cooks, catering, printing and painting, metalwork, mechanical engineering, construction, fishing. So these are the professions which are associated with increased incidence of irritant contact. Now we will discuss a few irritant reactions which are specific to specific sites. Hand eczema, which is one of the most common type of irritant contact dermatitis, include patchy housewife type eczema affecting principally the dorsal surfaces and web of fingers, or a ring eczema. Both are the patterns associated with wet work and exposure to the detergents. Vesicles are less commonly seen in irritant than allergic or constitutional eczemas, and the principal clinical features are usually dryness and chapping. Another common pattern is an apron or extended fingertip eczema with dryness, redness, or fissuring affecting principally the palmar aspect of fingers and distal palm. This is an apron eczema. You see two fingers and a portion of palmar skin which is involved. Then, volatile airborne irritant contact eczema. This is the second type of irritant eczema. The fumes can be from acid, alkali, solvent, resins, or other irritant chemicals such as ammonia or formaldehyde. Irritant dust, including some mostly tropical wood, cement, fiberglass, rock wool, some metals and metal salts and powders. So these dust or airborne particles, they usually get settled at the periorbital region and in flexural surfaces. Then napkin dermatitis is again a variety of irritant contact dermatitis developed in situations of prolonged and too frequent contact with degraded urine or fecal material. You can call it as a cumulative insult dermatitis, most frequently in very young and in elderly, in those elderly individuals who are incontinent, who have incontinency with due to incontinency due to urine and feces. Napkin dermatitis is also because of frequent changes of absorbent napkins in infants are important, as the mild cleansers and protective paste or silicone-based cream can also induce irritant contact dermatitis. So if the napkin is changed very frequently but with cleansing as well, then it can also cause napkin dermatitis. Any dermatitis or secondary infection should be controlled with appropriate strength topical steroids or topical antimicrobial combination. Perianal dermatitis, because of mucosa fecus leak, occur in situation where there is hemorrhoids or poor sphincter control. Rigid or wet cleansing routine using aqueous cream or equivalent are of benefit. So if you are cleaning even with water frequently, you must have encountered that, because in patients with diarrhea, they complain of perianal dermatitis because of frequent washing. Then peristomal dermatitis. Then in case of stomas, it is necessary to maintain a protective seal between the stoma bag and the skin. Cosmetic intolerance, very important cause of irritant contact dermatitis, because of various cosmetics, toiletries, and skincare products, including sunscreen. Most reactions are mild and transient, and most consumers simply change to alternate product and be relieved. Eyelids are particularly susceptible to the irritants. Allergy is only excluded by comprehensive patch testing to both the products and the ingredients. If a product is not allergic and if of irritant nature, then just change the brand and it will be all right. Chelitis is another form of irritant contact dermatitis. They have a multifactorial etiology. Atopy is a predisposing cause. It can be because of lip licking, cosmetics, and medications. Phototoxicity. A number of chemicals only cause irritation after absorption by photons. The photoactivated chemical has altered properties, and which are directly tissue damaging. Such chemicals include sorolins, porphyrins, tetracyclines, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, phenothiazines, and amiodarone. All of them can cause phototoxicity. How to investigate? Irritant contact dermatitis is essentially a clinical diagnosis based on knowledge of nature and conditions of individual exposed in a context of their dermatitis. A complicated allergic contact dermatitis always need to be excluded by patch testing. So patch testing is used even in irritant contact dermatitis to exclude the allergic chemicals or allergens. But the new type of irritant patch testing is a new thing which you have to do. Quantifying the irritant response. This is again of not of a practical importance, but of a laboratory or research importance. Visual appraisal of skin erythema and surface changes is still widely used to assess the irritant reaction. A number of non-invasive techniques have developed in recent years, which permit objective evaluation of key changes to the skin. The optimal method to be used varies with nature of irritant. Most of the methods are used in laboratory and for research. For example, how to measure the erythema, which is induced by some irritant chemical. Among the most overt clinical feature of irritant dermatitis is erythema, which can be quantified by laser Doppler flowmetry, which provides a measure of superficial blood flow. A number of investigators have shown that LDF generally correlates well with visually assessed erythema and is capable of determining between negative and weakly positive irritant reactions. Then transepidermal water loss. Measuring instrument employ an open chamber, which when applied to the surface of the skin, water vapors evaporates, creating a water pressure gradient from which evaporative transepidermal water loss expressed in gram per meter square per hour is calculated. So an open chamber applied on the skin and water vapors evaporate, and then the gradient, water pressure gradient is measured. You can assess from just reading this that this is not a practical kind of measurement. Hydration. This parameter can objectively be measured by several devices based on differing biophysical approaches. Using the principles of capacity, hydration of stratum corneum measured to a depth of 0.1 millimeter, skin thickness. Although not extensively applied, high-frequency ultrasound have been proved valuable in assessing another aspect of irritant response, namely the skin thickness. The thicker is the skin, less is the possibility of damage, and less is the possibility of irritant contact. So all these four measurements, that is erythema, that is transepidermal water loss, hydration, and skin thickness, you just remember that these are the objective measurement of severity of irritant contact dermatitis. Although these objective measurements are not practical and are not done in day-to-day clinical use. Management. Chemical burn or acute irritant contact dermatitis. The initial treatment of acute irritant contact dermatitis or chemical burn is removal of that chemical by washing it with large volume of lukewarm water. If chemical is insoluble, then can be removed by application of soap solution. High pressure should not be used in washing the chemical because it will cause splashes to other part of the skin. For some chemicals, specific antidotes can be used. For example, 2.5% calcium gluconate gel for hydrofluoric acid. Where there is risk of toxicity from systemic absorption, as with chromic acid, hydrofluoric acid, or phenolic compounds or gasoline, early debridement of necrotic areas reduce the blood levels, and regular monitoring of blood, liver, and kidney functions are required. Ulcerated areas should be managed with antibacterial creams to prevent secondary infection and promote re-epithelialization. If there is surrounding inflammatory reaction, a moderate potency topical steroids can be applied. Vapor permeability dressings are recommended in view of the role of transepidermal water loss. and stimulating the barrier repair. Then management of the cumulative irritant contact dermatitis. The successful management required both prevention and subsequent treatment of dermatitis. Most important aspect of treatment is avoidance of cause. Then use of protective personal equipment like rubber or latex gloves can be used. The dermatitis required palliation of symptoms with topical steroids and emollient. And emollient alone have been shown to improve the barrier repair. The choice of emollient is important. Many kind of emollients are available in the market containing many chemicals. The choice can be variable and only the use will help you developing confidence in certain emollients. But the commonly used emollient is the Vaseline or emulsifying ointment. Combination of liquid paraffin and white salt paraffin is another cheap and commonly used emollient. In severe cases, phototherapy or systemic drugs like azathioprine and cyclosporine is required. But usually, such kind of drugs are reserved for allergic contact rather than irritant contact dermatitis. If there is secondary infection, then topical or systemic antimicrobial agents may be used. Prevention. Identification of susceptible individuals and appropriate carrier advice. Mechanization. Increased use of mechanization for wet and irritant work, that is installation of dishwasher, for example, machine washes will help in reducing the incidence of irritant contact dermatitis. Personal protective equipment, the protective aspect of gloves outweighs any potential to induce dermatitis. Barrier creams are designed to reduce the penetration of hazardous materials into the skin. Water in oil emulsions protect against aqueous irritants and oil in water against lipophilic material. Most claim to give a 4-hour protection, although others suggest applying on necessary basis. So these barrier creams are available with the name of barrier cream. And remember that water and oil, which is in mainly the lotions type of creams, lotion types, they are effective for aqueous irritants. And the ointment type are effective for lipophilic material. Water in oil creams and oil in water creams. Emollients or hand creams will help in prevent dryness and chapping of the skin and may also help in preventing...
Sir,
हाँ बोले?
जो अभी जो आपने बताया oil and water या water in oil इन दोनों में क्या difference है?
दोनों वाटर है. ऑयल एंड ऑयल जो होता है ना वो होता है ऑइंटमेंट. वाटर एंड ऑयल जो होते हैं ना ये ज्यादा इमल्शंस, ये वाटर एंड ऑयल ज्यादा इमल्शंस होते हैं. ऑयल एंड वाटर जो क्रीम फॉर्म में थोड़ी थिकनेस में फर्क होता है, लेकिन इनमें से कोई भी थिक ऑइंटमेंट नहीं, ये क्रीम्स के ही जुमरे में आएगा. ये वाटर एंड ऑयल थोड़ी सी उस क्रीम की कंसिस्टेंसी थोड़ी सी लोशन टाइप होगी और ऑयल एंड वाटर की थोड़ी सी थिकर हो, लेकिन क्योंकि दोनों वाटर में है तो इसलिए ये थिक ग्रीजी नहीं होंगे.
ओके सर, थैंक यू.
सोप सब्स्टिट्यूट्स हैव बीन शोन टू बी इफेक्टिव इन प्रिवेंटिंग डर्मेटाइटिस लाइक चेंजिंग फ्रॉम द नॉर्मल सोप टू हैंड वॉशेस. हैबिट ऑफ यूजिंग ब्रश व्हेन स्क्रबिंग फॉर सर्जिकल प्रोसीजर्स हैव बीन शोन टू इंक्रीज the transepidermal water loss without any additional benefit in reducing bacterial contamination. So this practice should be stopped and should be and the surgeons should be advised to stop this practice. Then this is a very frequent advice to patients, especially the females which come to our OPD, because hand eczema is one of the commonest form of eczema which we encounter. Use hand creams many times a day so that the skin does not become dry. Use steroid cream or ointment prescribed by doctor whenever required. Washing hands. Use lukewarm water and soap substitute, that is, for example, aqueous cream. Emulsifying ointment is another kind of soap substitute. If soap is used, find a soap with no fragrance, tar or sulfur. Avoid contact with detergents and other cleansing agents. If gloves are worn, use plastic rather than rubber gloves. Avoid contact with shampoo. Either use plastic gloves or get someone else to wash your own or your children's hairs. Do not apply hair products with bare hands. That is most gel lotions, colorants. Do not peel citrus fruit with bare hands, oranges, lemon. It also includes other fruits and vegetables which emit juices. Avoid contact with polishes like metal, shoe, floor, car, furniture, window, and wax. Avoid contact with solvents like
Sir, voice nahi aa rahi, sir.
Sir, Lado. I think, sir, her connection is dropped.
Sir, please unmute yourself.
Okay. Avoid contact with solvents like white spirit, brush cleaners, petrol, trichloroethylene, xylene, carbon tetrachloride. These are all the chemicals which are used in houses. Wear gloves in cold weather. Patient with hand eczema should not be involved in commercial food preparation because the bacteria that they cause infection may also cause food poisoning. So this is important. This is why we frequently check the cooks in our messes for this hand eczema. So even if you are having your mother or your maid having the hand eczema, she should be she should avoid coming in contact with foods. Prognosis: over one third patients had complete remission of their dermatitis. It is possible that the irritant contact dermatitis is cured. Atopic individuals are known to have worse prognosis. Change of job may be helpful if undertaking, if can be taken early, but less beneficial to those with established and chronic dermatitis. Some workers, repeated exposure to irritant seems to develop hardening. Ye phenomena pehle bataya tha ki because of repeated exposure, the skin fails to get sensitized. This is described as hyporesponsive next to a chemical after repeated exposure. This is not a common response but can occur in certain chemicals. Some hand eczemas which start as irritant or allergic contact dermatitis subsequently persist when original cause have been eliminated. Some eczemas simply become self-perpetuating. In occupational setting, this has been labeled as persistent post-occupational dermatitis and affect 11% of individuals in absence of any other contributing factor. So other things which are not related to that particular chemical can initiate and propagate this kind of eczema. But one third of the patients are usually cured from the eczema. So that's all for the irritant contact dermatitis. Now, any questions are welcome. Any questions?
Sir, currently subjective dermatitis, if you repeat, you said that पेशेंट आता है तो उसको आपने डॉजर नहीं डिक्लेयर करना
नहीं वो तो एक एक इसमें फिनोमेना लिखा है जिसमें कहा गया है कि सब्जेक्टिव इरिटेंट इरिटेशन होती है जिसमें ना पेशेंट को कोई ऑब्जेक्टिव साइन नहीं होते लेकिन एक स्टिंगिंग और एक अनकंफर्टेबल सेंसेशंस होती हैं बिकॉज ऑफ सम इरिटेंट देयर इज लिटिल और नथिंग टू सी बट इंडिविजुअल्स कंप्लेन ऑफ सब्जेक्टिव सेंसेशन ऑफ स्टिंगिंग बर्निंग और स्मार्टिंग अगर आपको कोई ऐसा पेशेंट आके कहता है कि मुझे किसी काम से या किसी चीज से बर्निंग या इरिटेशन हो रही है मेरे पास कई एक पेशेंट्स आके ये कहती हैं कि हमें ना चेहरे के ऊपर बर्निंग और इरिटेशन हो रही है और कोई साइन नहीं होता आप उनसे पूछें तो कहें मैं तो बहुत अरसे से चीजें इस्तेमाल कर रही हूँ या जो भी कर रही हूँ तो इसको आप सब्जेक्टिव इरिटेंट रिस्पॉन्स कह सकते हैं लेकिन हो सकता है कि कुछ अरसे के बाद ये सब्जेक्टिव रिस्पॉन्स एक ऑब्जेक्टिव रिएक्शन में कन्वर्ट हो जाए
सर तो ये तो साइकोलॉजिकल भी हो सकता है
साइकोलॉजिकल तो हर चीज हो सकती है ना, जाहिर है जो चीज नजर, इसीलिए तो आप उनको डॉजर लेबल करेंगे। लेकिन एक बंदा बार बार आपको एक कंप्लेन के साथ आएगा, तो यही आपको बताने का मकसद तो यही है ना कि इसको भी कंसिडर करें, बजाय उसको स्ट्रेट अवे डॉजर डिक्लेयर करने के या साइकोलॉजिकल प्रॉब्लम डिक्लेयर करने के। क्योंकि कुछ लोगों को विदाउट एनी ऑब्जेक्टिव साइन इरिटेंट रिएक्शन हो सकता है।
सर आज का लेक्चर सर जो आपका है माशाल्लाह सर बहुत अच्छा प्रिपेयर्ड था सर, और जो चैप्टर 129 है सर इरिटेंट कॉन्टैक्ट डर्मेटाइटिस का, सर आपने सर इस स्लाइड से ये लग रहा है सर कि इन एडिशन टू दैट 129 चैप्टर आपने और चैप्टर्स भी या फिर सर रूप से एक्स्ट्रा फिर सर आपने पॉइंट्स
आप ये कह रहे हो कि पहले वाले लेक्चर में तैयार नहीं करता था, अब तैयार किया मैंने आज।
नो नो सर, मतलब जो जो इरिटेंट वाला चैप्टर है सर मैं रूप उसके साथ फॉलो कर रहा हूँ, लेकिन काफी चीजें उससे एक्स्ट्रा भी सर मिल रही हैं सर।
अच्छा पता है क्या बात है कि ये ना ये लेक्चर मेरा ना कोई पुराना तैयार है, और मैंने ना इसको थोड़ा सा अपडेट किया, और मैंने खुद देखा कि ग्रुप में ना इरिटेंट कॉन्टैक्ट डर्मेटाइटिस की चीजें कुछ कम थी, तो
बहुत कम है सर।
कम होने में मतलब ज्यादा होने में कोई नुकसान नहीं है, कम होने में नुकसान होता है, तो इसलिए शायद आपको लगा कि ये चीजें कुछ थोड़ी सी रुख से ज्यादा है। वरना जनरली ना मेरा लेक्चर्स में ना कोई इरादा नहीं होता मैं रुख से एक्स्ट्रा जाऊँ, मैं समझता हूँ कि अगर आप रुकी को पढ़ने तभी बहुत बड़ी बात है, तो इसलिए
सर
तो
ये
आइंदा ना देखें आप ऐसे। जी
सर ये सब्जेक्टिव में जब फिर कोई लियन नहीं होगा तो फिर हम इसे ट्रीट कैसे करेंगे?
देखो सबसे पहली तो चीज ये है कि आप उसे हिस्ट्री लेंगे कि आपको किस चीज से सर। अगर जो चीज आपको इरिटेशन कर रही है, चाहे नजर नहीं आ रहा लेकिन अगर स्टिंगिंग सेंसेशन कर रही है, तो आपकी ऑब्वियस एडवाइस उसकी अवॉइडेंस ही होगी ना। अच्छा ये जो इरिटेंट कॉन्टैक्ट डर्मेटाइटिस होते हैं या इवन एलर्जिक होते हैं, इनको ना सबसे पहले हम ट्रीट करते हैं बाय इमल्सिफाइंग ऑइंटमेंट और बाय इमोलियंट्स, देन हम उनको ना स्टीरॉयड्स एडवाइस करते हैं। तो अभी भी एडवाइस यही होनी चाहिए कि आप कोई उसको अच्छा सा कोई इमोलियंट एडवाइस कर दें, कोई आप इचिंग कम करने के लिए कोई उसको एंटी हिस्टामिन दे दें, और साथ आप कोई वो दे दें कोई यूज करते हैं कि जिसमें ना पेन सेंसेशंस हो रही है और वो नर्व एंडिंग्स है, वो वाले केमिकल्स निकल रहे हैं। यहाँ पे तो इरिटेशन की वजह या बर्निंग की वजह लोकल डैमेज है, तो यहाँ पे तो वो वाले मीडिएटर्स तो रिलीज नहीं हो रहे जो नर्व एंडिंग्स में रिलीज होते हैं। यहाँ पे साइटोकाइंस हैं और इंटरल्यूकिंस हैं, तो थियोरेटिकली तो नहीं, लेकिन शायद ट्राई करके देख लें, अगर बहुत कोई ज्यादा हो तो ट्राई करके देखा जा सकता है। थियोरेटिकली तो नहीं, ज्यादा बेहतर होगा कि हम NSAID दें, वो जो एंटी इन्फ्लेमेटरी ड्रग्स हैं, वो शायद आपको ज्यादा बेहतर पेन रिलीफ कर सके।
तो जो ट्रांस एपिडर्मल वाटर लॉस वाला टेस्ट है वो प्लीज दोबारा थोड़ा समझा दें कि कैसे करते हैं।
अच्छा ना मैंने किया है और ना कभी करने का इरादा है, लेकिन आप लोग सिर्फ इसलिए इम्पोर्टेंट है कि जरा एक टेस्ट होता है बस। इसमें यह है कि एक ओपन चैम्बर को लगा दिया स्किन सर्फेस पे, और जो स्किन का वाटर जो एवेपोरेट हो रहा है वो उस चैम्बर के अंदर एवेपोरेट हो रहा है, और उस चैम्बर में समहाउ एक वाटर प्रेशर ग्रेडियंट क्रिएट हो रहा है, और उस वाटर प्रेशर ग्रेडियंट को आप ऑब्जेक्टिवली मेजर कर रहे हैं इन ग्राम पर मीटर स्क्वायर पर आर। मैंने ये इंस्ट्रूमेंट देखा नहीं, लेकिन इट इज इन अ फॉर्म ऑफ सम इंस्ट्रूमेंट जो स्किन पे लगाया जाएगा और वो ये रीडिंग देगा ट्रांस एपिडर्मल वाटर लॉस।
ओके सर, थैंक यू सर। ये जो टेस्ट हो रहे हैं ये ट्रांस एपिडर्मल वाटर लॉस है और LDF है, ये हम पाकिस्तान में कहीं पे होते हैं या फिर हमने नाम याद रखने हैं इसके?
पाकिस्तान वो तो मैं आपसे कह रहा हूँ कि ना मैंने कभी किया ना कभी इरादा है करने का, इतना मतलब कि ये सिर्फ जो टेस्ट है ना ये मैंने आपको लिखा कि ये लेबोरेटरी में किए जाएंगे या ये इसकी ना इम्पोर्टेंस जो है वो रिसर्च पर्पज के लिए। फॉर एग्जाम्पल आप कोई कोई बैरियर क्रीम ट्राई कर रहे हैं स्किन के ऊपर, अब आप बैरियर क्रीम ट्राई कर रहे हैं कि वो कहते हैं और उसको आप क्लेम कर रहे हैं कि ये ट्रांस एपिडर्मल वाटर लॉस को कम कर रही है, तो फिर आप उस बैरियर क्रीम को लगा के ये टेस्ट करेंगे और जो प्लेसिबो है उसको लगा के टेस्ट करेंगे, या आप कोई ऐसी क्रीम कर रहे हैं जिससे आप कह रहे हैं कि इससे हाइड्रेशन इंप्रूव होती है, देन आप हाइड्रेशन चेक करेंगे विद डिफरेंट मेजरमेंट्स, बायोफिजिकल अप्रोचेज और बाकी स्टेटम कॉर्नियम की जो भी ये टेस्ट्स हैं, और आप ये करेंगे कि हाँ इसकी क्रीम की वजह से हाइड्रेशन स्किन की इंप्रूव हो रही है। तो ये इन टेस्ट की वैल्यू ज्यादा रिसर्च में या डेवलपिंग ऑफ अ ऑफ सम इमोलियंट और हाइड्रेशन क्रीम और मॉइस्चराइजर हो सकती है, लेकिन हमारी ना डे टू डे प्रैक्टिकल एप्लीकेशन नहीं है।
कॉपीड सर,
ठीक है जी। आज यार आपने मुझे डिप्रेस कर दिया कि मेरे ना आज का लेक्चर तैयार था और इससे पहले लेक्चर तैयार ही नहीं थे।
नहीं सर, ये मतलब तो नहीं था सर, लेकिन मतलब आज का मटेरियल बहुत ज्यादा था सर।
ओके जी, थैंक यू,
थैंक यू सर,
थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू वेरी मच सर, अल्लाह हाफिज।